So today we are going to talk about the various parts or the four important parts of the ocean relief that we spoke about previously. So the first part we are going to talk about is continental shelf. Out of the four parts that we are going to talk about, this is going to be the most important one. Why? Why is this going to be the most important one, continental shelf? Because it is the closest to us. Why is it the closest to us? Because let's try to understand this. Let me first quickly draw probably this. So let's say this is the land, right? This is the land, then this and this. Yeah. So this is basically the land and this is the water level, right? And this area is entire area is submerged. This is the ocean, right? That is the fundamental thing. So now this is land. This is where we all reside. So the closest area to us is going to be this area. This area is actually known as continental shelf. I'll explain to that. Don't worry. This area is the continental shelf. So why it is the most important? Because firstly, it is the closest to us, the residents on the land. Right. So, what exactly is the continental shelf? Continental shelf is basically nothing but the seaward extension of the continent. Right. So, it is a seaward extension of the continent. So, it is like the continent itself is extending to some part of the sea, some part below the sea also. It is like, you know, it is just like a continuum, right, that is going on. And it is just the extension of the land itself, the extension of the continent itself within the sea. It is the shallowest part of the sea, right? It is the shallowest part of the sea, and it has a number of the ocean. It has the shallowest part of the ocean, and it usually has very shallow seas in itself and shallow gulfs. And all these things are there in this, right? Now, this is obviously the beginning of the ocean. So, it obviously has to be the most shallow part of the ocean. This is also very gentle in the slope, right? So, those of you who have gone to the beach, I'm sure most of you would have gone to some beach or the other in life. So, when we on the beach, when we start walking towards the ocean, or, you know, when we just take a few steps into the ocean, we are basically walking on the continental shelf, right? So, does it have a very steep slope? If it has a very steep slope, we might even fall into the sea. That does not happen. It has the gentlest of the slope. It has a very, very gentle slope. And the slope is so gentle that it almost looks flat, right? The slope is kind of negligible. It's such a small slope, such a gentle slope that is there. The gradient is usually less than 1 degree. The gradient, that means the slope, is usually less than 1 degree. If you remember, you know, those protectors that we used to use in the school time to draw the angles, just get one of them and see how less an angle 1 degree is. 1 degree is also written in the NCERT, that's why I'm using. In some other sources like Gonchelion and all, it is written that 1 in 500, right? That will be even less than 1 degree. But again, that is a trigonometric expression, so I'll not be using that. We anyway have to trust the NCERT with the information for any public service examination. So, 1 degree is the usually, again, there is no hard and fast rule, but usually 1 degree is the, or less than 1 degree is the slope. That is a very, very important aspect. Now, this goes on for quite some time, right? If you go to the sea, this might go on for a very, very long time. And then there is a switch. As we can see, it's a very gentle slope going here. And then suddenly, very steep slope is coming up, right? So, this point, where this slope actually takes a twist. The slope actually becomes steeper all of a sudden. This is known as the shelf break. This point is known as the shelf break, and continental shelf boundary is only till the shelf break. Continental shelf is only till the shelf break. After that, the continental slope starts coming. That we will be discussing later. Don't worry about that. But the continental shelf is basically starting from the land, where the land and sea touch, from this point to this point. That is the boundary of the, that is the basic domain, basic range of the continental shelf, right? Now, how wide it can be, how long it is going to be, it varies from sea to sea, right? From ocean to ocean. In some oceans, in some places, it is as big. In some oceans, you know, for example, it is as big as 1500 kilometer. While in some oceans, it is, you know, it is practically absent, right? So, it is practically absent also, or it is only a few kilometers also in certain spaces. So, you know, for example, if you go to Chile, remember South America, again, I am saying this, you are attending any of my geography lectures, please sit down with an atlas. So, if you look at the Latin America, the South America, you will see again, my world map is not great. But again, you can see the Chile looks something like this, very narrow kind of a place it is. So, the Andes Mountains are here. In South America, the Andes Mountains are here. So, now just imagine, the mountains are there and there is coast just next to the mountain. So, the mountain is coming like this, right? It has a higher slope, obviously it's a mountain. So, and then, you know, suddenly the water starts. So, it doesn't happen that the mountain changes its method. The slope goes like this only. So, practically absent. So, it is directly, almost directly the continental slope comes in and the continental shift is practically absent. It is practically absent in Chile. On the Chile coast, there is no continental shelf. Similarly, the west coast of Sumatra, same thing again. On the west coast of Sumatra, there is hardly any continental shelf present. So, that is another very important thing. On the other hand, on the Arctic, in the Arctic Ocean, on the Siberia, you will see continental shelf as big as 1,500 kilometers also. For 1500 kilometers also, you will see that the continental shelf is actually going on and on and on. I'm talking about this length, this distance basically. This can be up to 1500 kilometers also and practically almost zero also, right? And this depth, how much is this depth going to be? Again, this depth can be as low as 30 meters. And can be as high as 600 meters. That means this depth where the shelf break comes in and continental shelf ends. That may be 30 meters below the sea level and as much as 600 meters below the sea level also. It is variable. It is variable. But, you know, that is the basic idea that, you know, that is how it is done. It is calculated. It can be anything. I mean, it's variable. But the basic point is that this area, the beginning of the sea with a gentle slope, is actually known as the continental shelf. One very important discussion is that how did they get made? How did we actually get to see, or how were these continental shelves actually made? There are three basic ideas which actually are important for this. One idea says that when continental shelves were basically land only, right? Up to the ice age, continental shelf was basically land. Water was not there. But after the ice age, what happened? The ice melted, or in the end of the ice age, the ice started melting, and because of that, the sea level started rising. And because of that rising sea level, some extensions of the land, some low-lying land actually got submerged. And that became the continental shelf. Very simple. simplistic explanation. You know, like these days we say that probably in another 2 decades or so, we might not even have Maldives. We know that, right? Many people say that even the low-lying, even the coastal cities like Calcutta, coastal cities, various other coastal cities are at the risk of getting submerged because the sea level is rising due to global warming. So just imagine it's a planar city, and if it gets submerged, it will also become a part of the continental shelf, right? Again, just giving you an example. Don't get, if you are from Calcutta, please don't get very scared. I'm just giving an example, right? So that is the example. So one theory says that it was basically land only. And because of the heating, because of the melting of the ice, the sea level rose. And because of that rise in sea level, it actually became, it got submerged and became a part of the continental shelf. That is the first thing. Second theory says that it is not the case that, you know, this continental shelf has actually been formed by the erosion. How does that theory explain? Let me quickly try to explain it to you by making this quick diagram. So let's say if this was the land, right? Then the sea was coming up to here, right? This was the land, and sea was coming up to here. And sea, because of the waves, sea does not just stay still. There are waves also. And waves started eroding the land, you know, here. And because of that, what happened? This erosion actually led to creation of the landform like this. So this was the original, and this is after erosion. Ignore this, right? This is after erosion. So can you see that this was the original landform, but the sea waves kept coming. They kept coming, they kept hitting, and because of hitting, they kept eroding the surface, and they made this surface a little planar, and because of that, this gentle slope-based continental shelf has been created. That is another theory. Another theory is that it is not the case. It was actually steep only. Another theory says that no, it used to be steep only. It used to be steep, but the sea was coming. And sea also carries a lot of depositions, right? Waves come, they carry sediments. And because of that, what happened? The sediment started getting deposited. And because of that, this kind of continental shelf got formed. So, there is a erosion theory, there is a deposition theory also. So, all these theories are there, which actually give different perspectives on how the continental shelf could have been formed. You may trust any of them. That is totally up to you, right? But again, one theory says that none of them is the actual case, or maybe it is the mixture of all of them, right? That is a very, very important aspect. Now, why the continental shelves are very important? Why are they important? First thing, the sea waves carry a lot of depositions, right? Please remember that. Note it down. What I'm saying right now, please note it down. Why the continental shelves are geopolitically so important? They are geopolitically extremely important because the contestations that you would be seeing in various countries about the important minerals that are lying at the sea, they are usually on the continental shelves, right? So why? Because of these depositions, right? The sea carries the depositions by the rivers, by the winds, by various currents. All these depositions are there in the sea. And these deposits are getting deposited on the continental shelf because the slope is gentle. If the slope is gentle, the speed of water will reduce. And if the water speed reduces, then it will deposit more. So more and more things get deposited on the continental shelf. And over the centuries, over the millennia, they become what? They become fossil fuels. So continental shelves are very rich in fossil fuels. Please remember that. They are rich in fossil fuels. And they are a very, very important centers of the fossil fuels that make the world's economies, right? I mean, almost all the countries extremely interested and extremely intrigued by the possibility of exploiting or exploring the continental shelves of various seas for the recovery of a number of minerals, right? So that is the first reason why continental shelves are very important, that they are they are the center, or they are some kind of a depository or some kind of a repository of fossil fuels. Apart from that, continental shelves are usually shallow. They are usually shallow. If they are shallow, they receive a lot of sunlight, because the sunlight is not able to reach till the bottom of the ocean, right? But on the continental shelf, because it is shallow, more sunlight reaches there, right? And because of that sunlight, there are a lot of planktons. What are planktons? What are planktons? Planktons are these small, water-based insects, which are the food for fish, right? Planktons are these small, insects or very tiny fish or something, which are basically the food for the fish. So, and they grow only when there is the insects or vegetation also, which is basically eaten by the fish. Now, these planktons need sun rays or sunlight to grow. So, on the continental shelf, the growth of plankton is higher. If there are more planktons on the continental shelf, then it is extremely obvious, more fish will be found on the continental shelf also, right? So, because of that reason, it is extremely important. They become some very, very important areas of the fishing in the world, right? So, for example, the Sunda Shelf in Indonesia or in the Southeast Asia. Remember the Sunda Shelf. Again, that is why I say, please sit down with the atlas. The Sunda Shelf or the Grand Bank of the Newfoundland. Where is this? It is in North America, in the Newfoundland, right? The Grand Bank there, the Northern Sea, all these areas, the continental shelf of all these areas are extremely important fishing areas, and that becomes another very important economic aspect of continental shelf. The next relief feature we are going to talk about is the continental slope. I'm sure if you remember the diagram that I had made earlier, then you would realize what continental slope is. So we realized that this was continental shelf, right? If this is water level, then this was the continental shelf, then this area. Why I'm drawing this, I'll tell you. Yeah. So this area was the continental shelf. This was shelf break, remember? And after the shelf break, the area that comes, that is known as the continental slope. Fairly simple. After the shelf break, the area that comes up, that is called the continental slope. And when we talk of continental slope, I'm sure the name also suggests that the indicator of the beginning of the continental slope is an abrupt change in the slope. Or I would say an abrupt increase in the gradient. There is an abrupt increase. No? If it is a gentle increase, it is not going to be gentle. If it is gentle, then it will continuum of the continental shelf. Please understand, the abrupt word is very important here. This change of slope, because the change of slope can be very abrupt or can be very gentle also. But if it is gentle, then it is not the beginning of the continental slope. It is going to be abrupt only. Right. So, the abrupt increase in the gradient. Again, I'm telling you that the diagrams I'm making here, they are only for the representational purposes. For example, the diagram I have made here, it shows you that the slope is what, almost 70 degree or so. It is not like that. Even on the continental slope, the slope which we call as very steep, it is the steep slope. But even this steep slope is from 2 degrees to 5 degrees. Right, again, use a protector, right? Draw a straight line. Please do that practice so that you get an actual idea. 2 degree to 5 degree probably will be something like this. 5 degree will be probably, in fact, less than that, right? So, the slope is this much, Right. But again, as compared to the continental shelf, which was just very, very minor, which was almost like zero slope, as compared to that, this slope is very, very steep. That is a very important aspect. So, I think that is understood as compared to the continental shelf. Again, if I draw the diagram with this slope, you will not be able to make out the difference. So, that is why in the books also, everywhere we draw the diagrams like this, but these are the representational diagrams, right? They do not represent the actual slopes. Please understand this point. Don't think that, okay, the sea looks like this or the ocean looks like this. It's a massive, massive body, right? So, now the edge, the border of this, the border of the continental slope actually reflects that the continent is now over. This is the continent's boundary, right? As the names also suggest, right? This is the continental shelf. This is the continental slope. After that, the areas that will come, they will have the prefix as oceanic. So, up to this point, up to the point where continental slope is there, here, up to here, we say that this is a part of the continent only. After this part, whatever will come, it will be called as the oceanic. So, that is a very, interesting, very important part. The depth of it is from 200 to 3000 meters, right? And, it has a number of trenches and all these features are available in continental slope also. That is a interesting part that you need to know. Again, nothing very important. Interesting part comes as the next part of let me draw it here. So now we will be covering this part or the ocean deeps slightly separately. Now, after the continental slope is over, there is a rather plain part that is known as the deep sea plain, right? This was the third continental shelf. No, this was the second continental shelf, continental slope. Third is deep sea plain. Now, what exactly is deep sea plain? Deep sea plain is nothing but an undulating plain, right? Now, in some textbooks, you will find that it is the most smooth surface ever, right? So, even in the NCERTs, you will find that written, that continental slope is incredibly smooth, right? They are the smoothest surfaces possible and there is hardly any feature, right? So, this is basic, but again, that is not really true. In the, it has been proven. I'll tell it to you. It is basically an undulating plane. It is an undulating plane and this is 3 to 6 kilometers below the sea surface. So, earlier it was a belief, right? 3 to 6 kilometers below the sea level, it is found that there is an incredibly smooth plane that is called as the deep sea plain, and in terms of the vast expanses of the sea, of the ocean, majority of the ocean is basically deep sea plain. Majority of the ocean floor is actually deep sea plain. Usually up to 2/3 of the ocean floor is actually deep sea plain. As you can see, right? These all look like transitional things. While deep sea plain is a large plain, right? It's a long plain which is there, right? So this is also known as, it is also termed as abyssal plain because it was, let me write it probably here. It was also known as abyssal plain because it was presumed that there is nothing going on in this zone of the sea. That was the older belief. But later with technology, we use the sound machines, right? The machines which create sound. How do they do that? They basically send the waves, sound waves, and the waves hit the floor and they come back, right? They reverberate. And using their reverberations, we are able to measure the depths of various areas. using those machines we have found, using those techniques we have found, that this claim that this is an absolutely incredibly smooth plane is not true. Even these these deep sea planes, I wrote it in a terrible handwriting, it's deep sea plane, even these deep sea planes, they have a number of plateaus, right? They have a number of ridges, they have a number of trenches, they have basins, they have oceanic islands also. What are oceanic islands? They have oceanic islands also. So they are not free of features. There are features, but obviously, you know, just imagine that it's a very, very vast area, and there are some features there. So they don't appear to be that important, but it is not that it is absolutely smooth. Oceanic islands is basically the area, you know, that there is some kind of a hill here, and that hill, you know, just imagine the water is here up to here, and there was a hill. That hill, some part of that hill actually comes out. It's a plateau. It's some kind of a plateau, but that plateau, some part of that plateau comes above the water. So it becomes what? It becomes an island. Right, it becomes some kind of an island. So that is a very important aspect. It is some kind of a oceanic islands which are there. So for example, the Azore Island, you will be able to see they are a part of Portugal. You know, if you go to the map of Europe, Spain and Portugal, and go leftwards towards it, you will see the Azore Island. That is basically some kind of an oceanic island only. That is based on the oceanic plain, right? So, on the oceanic plain, some kind of a hill is there which has come above the sea level and has become a small tiny island. So, that is all we need to know about the deep sea plain. As the last part of the ocean relief, now we are going to talk about a very interesting part. That is ocean deeps. Now, as the name suggests, ocean deeps, they are supposed to be very deep, right? So, let me draw it here once again. So, we have seen the continental shelf, then continental slope. Not like this. Let me, continental slope, right? It's not absolutely straight. Then the plains, and then there are these kind of things. Right. So, these are the areas which are the ocean deeps. Right. There is water all over it. There should be no confusion. So, these are the areas which are basically very, very deep. Right. I mean, they are long, narrow and deep trenches. They are very long, very narrow and very deep trenches. They are not supposed to be very wide or something. They are narrow, they are long, and their slope is almost vertical, right? Slope wise, they are usually almost vertical. Now, here I am talking about the slope, right? So, the slope is almost vertical, right? That is a very, very important part. And these are the areas that actually form some of the deepest points on planet Earth. I will be telling you, at the end of this section, the depth of some of these trenches, and you will be shocked at the numbers, right? I mean, if you don't know it already, you will be shocked at the numbers, I'll tell you. But the point is that these are the deeper trenches, right? And they go very, very deep inside the Earth, right? And now, we would like to believe normally that if there is an oceanic plain going on and there is a trench, it will be probably, you know, let's say if there is a continent and there is a continent here, then we would believe that the trench will lie right at the center. We would like to believe that, but that is not the case. Trenches always lies, I would say if there is a continent, there is an island on the same line as the arch of the island, right? Very close to the continent. All the trenches, all the big trenches you will find in the world, they are found closer to the continent, not in the central zones, right? They are closer to the continents on the arch of the island itself, right? There will be a series of trenches or a trench which will be on the arch itself. That is a very interesting part, right? And it is absolutely almost vertical, right? These trenches, they are the center of activities. They are very important active. They are very important for active volcanoes and earthquakes. Because obviously they go very, very deep into the earth. So they play a very, very important role in the active volcanoes which are working, which are there in the sea, as well as on the, in the matter of earthquakes. I'm sorry. As of now, there are 57 important trenches that have been discovered. Out of these 57, 32 are in the Pacific Ocean and 19 are in Atlantic Ocean and 6 are in Indian Ocean. So that is a rough distribution of the trenches which are available, which are there. This data might be updated from time to time if there are the discoveries of the new trenches also. Now coming to the staggering numbers, what is the highest point on Earth? I think that is a basic GK question. We all must have heard that. What is the highest point on Earth? We all know that the highest point on Earth is the Mount Everest, which is how high? 8,848 meters. We know that, that is the height of the Mount Everest Mount Everest peak. That is the highest peak on the planet Earth. Now, just imagine a situation. If I break Mount Everest from the sea level and put it in the deepest trench of the world, will it fit? My question is that, and what is the deepest trench in the world? The deepest trench in the world is known as Mariana Trench. The deepest trench in the world is known as Mariana Trench. Now imagine if I pluck Mount Everest from the planet Earth and put it in the Mariana Trench, will it fit? The answer is, it will not just fit, there will be 3 more kilometers left. So Mariana Trench is as deep as 11,034 meters. It is more than 11 kilometers deep. So it can suck the entire Mount Everest and still have almost 2,200 meters left. So are you getting the point that I'm trying to make? That the deepest point of the Earth is much, much deeper than the height of the highest point of the Earth. So, and it is not the only one. It is not that only Mariana Trench beats the Mount Everest. No, the second highest trench in the world is the Tonga Trench. How high is Tonga Trench? Tonga Trench is 10.9 kilometer high. Sorry, deep. I'm sorry. It's a trench. Tonga Trench is 10.9 kilometer deep. So it can also take the entire Mount Everest into it and still have space left. The third highest, The third highest is the Philippines Trench, which is also known as Mindanao Trench. The Mindanao Trench, that is the other name for it. That is also 10.54 kilometer deep. So you can see even this, for these top three trenches, Mariana, Tonga and Philippines Trench, they all are deeper than the height of Mount Everest. After that, the Japan Trench, it is again marginally less. The Japan Trench, it is 8.04 kilometer deep, right? So as a homework, since I have been requesting you guys for a very long time to sit with the atlases, there is a homework for you. Locate these four trenches on the world map. Where is Mariana Trench? Where is Tonga Trench? Where is Philippine Trench? Easier to notice, obviously, and Japan Trench, again, very easier to notice. These four trenches, the location of these, you need to find out. That is your homework. And with this, we conclude these four parts of the ocean relief.